Hello, I'm Caitlin McFarland, and this is Emily Gibson, and we are the co-founders of ATX TV and are excited to welcome you to a special event presented by National Geographic for their Disney Plus series, The Right Stuff. I do have to say I might be hearing a new Kids on the Block song in my head every time I say the title.
I'm really glad you said that because it definitely starts playing every time we talk about the show, even though that might show our age a little bit.
I definitely think it does, but as children of the late 80s and 90s, I'm here to represent. But in all seriousness, this is a classic film adapted to TV series, obviously based on true life events that we personally have been waiting for some time. In fact, we heard about it before Disney Plus even launched, and it stars a few ATX alums and one of our ambassadors front and center.
Yes, Patrick J. Adams is fantastic in this series as John Glenn. And during this conversation, we'll get to find out what it was like for him to portray a real life person. And this also is his first big series since Suits.
Yes. Normally, we at ATX shy away from a panel that has all of the same type of job represented. We like to have a lot of different people represented, showcasing the collaborative nature of television and what it takes to accomplish what you see on the screen. But today's panel is special. Actors only.
When National Geographic asked if we could do a panel to showcase the actors who took on the incredibly daunting task of portraying the astronauts of Mercury Seven, we thought it would be an amazing opportunity to hear how many different people approach the same challenge. Focusing on a singular skill of acting in this panel is really what makes it so impressive.
So with that, we will get off the screen and let these incredibly fine actors, and in our own personal opinion, great people, tell you all about The Right Stuff. Enjoy.
Hi, I'm Kate Hahn from TV Guide Magazine. Welcome to the panel for The Right Stuff, the first scripted Disney Plus series from National Geographic. This series takes a deep dive into the lives of the United States' very first astronauts. It's based on true accounts from the best-selling nonfiction book by Tom Wolfe. It spans 1959 to 1961 and covers the selection, training, and mission of the Mercury Seven, military test pilots tasked with beating the Soviet Union in the race to get into space. We're very lucky to have all the actors who play the astronauts here with us today. Patrick J. Adams as Major John Glenn, Jake McDorman as Lieutenant Commander Alan Shephard, Colin O'Donoghue as Captain Gordon Cooper, James Lafferty as Captain Scott Carpenter, Michael Trotter as Gus Grissom, Aaron Staton as Wally Schirra, and Micah Stock as Deke Slayton. Welcome, guys. Thank you so much for joining us. It's a great show and fans will be very excited to see the finale. Patrick, when we talked on set in Orlando, Florida, while you were shooting, you talked about doing extensive research for the role. Tell us about your research and what it told you about John Glenn.
I'd never played a role like this before, you know, a person who had lived and who had lived a pretty historic life. So I was a little overwhelmed at first about what my process was going to be. Obviously, the first thing I did was scoured the internet for everything I could find. So there was a lot of, you know, deep YouTube black holes and going to different websites that had all this information. But what I found was that the internet was mostly filled with, you know, what the public life of John Glenn was. He lived a lot of his life in public and in front of the camera. But that wasn't really going to help me, I think, to like, that certainly wouldn't help me to play a character over the course of 8 episodes. I felt like I needed more material. I came across this really, obviously I read all the books that I could find too, but even the books, they felt like sort of official records that had moved through the filter of John Glenn himself. And he had a very particular way, I think, of wanting the world to see him. And he cultivated that very specifically. So the one thing I found that kind of pierced behind the curtain of that was this 23-hour, I think it was that long, 23-hour oral history that he had given to a series of different journalists or archivists that was hosted at the Ohio State University website, where I saw they were from the John Glenn archives. So first I downloaded all of that and spent a lot of time listening to it, and just not the full 23 hours, but just sort of going on long walks and listening to it and kind of hearing these stories and listening to mostly how he told them. And then I realized where it had come from, the John Glenn archives. And I thought there's gotta be more where that came from. But online there was sort of, it was difficult to navigate and I couldn't find a ton of stuff. So I ended up reaching out to the archives, which this was the first time, again, I'd never played a character like this, of which there's so much written So I was kind of, I didn't know what I was doing, but felt like if I was looking for more personal stuff that wouldn't be available anywhere else, this seemed like a good place to start. So anyway, I got in touch with the archives. There were a couple of people there who were extremely helpful. I organized to have a number of boxes drawn. I think it was like 24 boxes of different stuff drawn. And then I flew to Ohio and just sat in the archives for a couple of days picking through those boxes. And that was the key to the whole thing for me. That gave me access to stuff that I don't think he even imagined would ever be read by anybody. I say that unsure because as a child of the Depression, he kept everything. I mean, like every receipt, every invitation to a state dinner, everything, every copy of every speech he ever wrote. So there's a lot in there. So I got the impression that maybe he thought one day somebody might want to be reading this. But even so, I felt like there were two boxes of letters between him and his wife, Annie, that spanned, I think, a total of like 20 years from when he went to boot camp. Like the night I read the letter from the night he left her, you know, and got on a train to go to boot camp.
So, Jake, tell us about your character and tell us about the big conflict that drives this story between him and John Glenn.
Yeah, I play Lieutenant Commander Alan B. Shephard. He's the first American in space, a Navy test pilot that was recruited to the Mercury program. He has that's one of the main overarching kind of storylines of a series is the rivalry between Shephard and John Glenn. I think they kind of sat at opposite ends of a spectrum, if you will. You know, Glenn came into the space program as already kind of a celebrity. You know, he was really adept at having a proactive relationship with the press. He was good in interviews. You know, he had been on a game show. He was already an ace pilot, fought in the war. So he was kind of this American hero that was really, really good at knowing how important a relationship with the press was, not just for his own vying to be first, but also for the space program at large. You know, public opinion and public interest in the space race, public opinion in getting America into space was vital to the space program's survival. And Glenn knew how to navigate that probably better than any of the other seven astronauts or the other six astronauts. Whereas Shephard, I think, you know, was sitting on the other side, much more, you know, like the other six, didn't ever have really any experience in the public eye. These guys were test pilots, you know, and their heroes weren't celebrities that were, you know, known across the globe. They were like Charles Limbaugh and Chuck Yeager for breaking the sound barrier. And all of a sudden, before these guys ever accomplished anything, they were kind of hurled into the spotlight and as famous as the Beatles, which was, you know, obviously disorienting for a lot of different reasons. So I think the line got blurry as to what was going to make the difference between one astronaut being first over the other. Alan, I think, was more in the camp of it should be on merit alone and ability alone, who's the best pilot, keep your head down and get the job done. And he viewed Glenn as trying to kind of politicize who should be first by, you know, making little cute remarks to the press. I love that I'm able to give this answer without Patrick being on the line right now. It's really great. you know, that I think was probably the main source of the rivalry. And at least what we explore on the show is just, you know, these competing ideologies for what makes someone worthy of being the first American in space.
And what research did you do? I remember you talked about reading his biography or autobiography.
Biography, yeah. Shephard was actually one of the only astronauts that didn't have an autobiography, which is why his was, for a lot of reasons, really interesting, because he didn't have any agency over writing it. It was written after he died. I think Neil Thompson worked at the Washington Post and was a journalist who was commissioned to write Shephard's obituary. And in doing so, realized there was never a book written about Shephard. And so he wrote Light This Candle. And I know that Patrick, I think, you know, and Shannon, who plays Shepard's wife, Louise, also read that book because it gave a really good account of the events from, you know, an unbiased perspective. You know, there was no reputation that was trying to be salvaged. It was really just trying to get to the nuts and bolts of what happened and who this guy was. And he was fiercely private. I mean, he didn't even write a book about it. So that reading that book was a big part of the research. Also just being in Florida and shooting where these events happened in Cape Canaveral and the Kennedy Space Center and getting to talk to real astronauts was a huge asset that we had. I mean, very early on, to Patrick Adams' credit, he put us all in kind of a group chain email where we could just pool all of our research that we found and share with each other different podcasts, different episodes of this and that. I mean, obviously, it's a very well-documented period of American history, so there's no shortage of research to do. But for Shephard specifically, I'd say it was, yeah, light this candle and talking to different astronauts at the Kennedy Space Center that had actually had interactions with him and stuff like that.
Well, Colin, you play Gordo Cooper, and I remember when we talked, you said that one of the great things was being able to sit in the F-104 jet that he actually flew. And Jake was just saying, you know, being in Florida, being in this environment was so important. Tell us about sitting in that jet and how it helped you form his character.
Well, yeah, it was sort of interesting to get to do that and sort of sit in the planes that these guys would have flown. You know, and these, you know, these test pilots were the guys who wrote the manual basically on these planes. Nobody had flown them before or whatever. But for me, it sort of did help because I came into the process quite late. So I didn't have as much time to prepare necessarily, you know, as some other people did. And so it kind of helped me a little bit to kind of feel what it must have been like for those guys. But you know, I think sitting in a stationary plane is very different than, you know, getting up there and flying it and trying to push it to its absolute limit. But you know, these guys were so complex and such complex characters, and you know, just to get to play any of them, I think was a dream, really.
Big part of the series too is his relationship with his wife. The astronaut families play into the whole series, but his is particularly fraught. Can you talk a little bit about developing that side of his character?
Yeah, so Gordo and Trudy, you know, they were separated when he joined the space program, and you couldn't be separated. You had to have a stable marriage, not only just for the space program, but I think even just to be a test pilot, to still be in the military, it was sort of frowned upon. And so essentially they pretended that they were still a happily married couple. And, you know, I think part of what we investigate in this version of The Right Stuff is, you know, what the impact of the fame that these guys all of a sudden found, you know, how that impacted on their family lives. And in particular, you know, we see quite a bit of Gordo and Trudy, which in a weird way is almost more the most sort of modern of the relationships, if you will, because, you know, Trudy was a test pilot, and I think that, you know, Gordo and Trudy very much respected each other for that and stuff, but it was a very complicated relationship. And, you know, luckily Eloise is absolutely magnificent, and, you know, when you get to work with somebody like that that you just click with, it makes it so much easier, because then it becomes a dance and you give each other permission to sort of play in the scenes and sort of work with each other in that way. So I was very, very lucky to have Eloise alongside me for that.
Well, Michael, you play Gus Grissom, who's the third of the final three that are chosen to potentially be the first man in space. What was it like to put on that silver Mercury suit?
Yeah, it was amazing. It was kind of surreal. I mean, they had the testament to Hope, who was head of our costume too, the attention to detail and just how specific it was to what those guys actually wore as well, just in terms of right down to, you know, the specific sort of plugins that they had. I mean, it was a pretty much a spot on replica of what they wore, you know, back then. I remember when I tried it on for the first time, it was I just asked pretty much anyone who was within an eye shot to pull out their phone and take a picture of me, because I was like, this needs to be recorded. And it was a blast. I mean, I think when anytime you get a job, there's a rare instance, I think, where you kind of high five your 12-year-old self. And when I put that spacesuit on, I was high-fiving young Michael quite often. So it was pretty thrilling.
Well, it's thrilling for the top three, but there's also some heartbreak that happens for some of the other guys. And James, I was wondering if you could talk about Scott Carpenter has a very heartbreaking moment when Shephard loses confidence in him. Can you talk about shooting that scene and how that affected your character?
Yeah. I was happy to get that scene because I think that was, you know, Scott's struggle to find his place within the program was kind of a reflection of like what he was going through personally at the time as well. I mean, it wasn't just where he fit in operationally within the program. It was kind of where he fit in with these other six really decorated military test pilots. Scott came into the program with a little bit less experience in the air. I mean, I think he had the fewest test pilot hours logged. He wasn't a combat pilot. He was flying patrol missions and reconnaissance missions in the Korean War. So he just had a different pedigree. And I think he had a bit of a different way about him in terms of just being a little bit more laid back, a little bit easier going in terms of like letting things come to him and enjoying that moment when it arrives. I think it caused him to fall behind in the program a little bit and gave him a bit of a reality check in terms of what it actually takes to compete at a level like this and to perform at a level like this.
Another heartbreak came for Deke Slayton. And Micah, that's your character. He has a medical issue. Tell me what it was like to shoot that scene where he's basically told, you know, you're not going up.
Well, that scene was actually the one of the scenes I auditioned for the series with. So I think it's one of those cool things where you can kind of track, you know, that scene was one of the reasons I was so connected to the, you know, I love the script in general and I love the show. But when I got to that scene, it was like, oh, you know, this is the juice. This is why we do this. And what's amazing is throughout the process, you know, you make a TV show, you're rewriting things. Constantly things are shifting, and that scene pretty much stayed the same from the day I auditioned for it to the day we shot it, which must have been an 8-month span. But Mark Lafferty and our writers, who are many, gave beautiful life to a lot of these scenes. And so it was honestly one of those moments as an actor where, you know, you get to just trust what's in front of you and kind of get out of the way.
We talked about the setting, 1959 to 1961. And Aaron, you play Wally Schirra, another astronaut who's not in the final three, but he does eventually go up into space. I wanted to talk to you about the time period, because you were in Mad Men for many years. Were you happy to be back in this mid-century world with the hair and the costumes and all the makeup?
Yeah, I mean, you know, as Michael was talking about Hope's job, and I mean, I find that whenever there's that type of detail that it makes the actor's job so much easier, because you walk in and there's really no work required. You don't have to do anything because everybody did everything for you. You just walk in, your hair's done, you got the costume, there's a spaceship. There it is, there's the rocket. Like the context is set by somebody else and you say these lines that are also very well written, and then that's the whole job.
What did the Mad Men characters make of the whole Mercury project? Was that before that show started, or?
No, funny. My wife and I just rewatched the first season, and it's been whatever, however many years ago that we filmed it, and certainly that it was on. But so for these astronauts to be mentioned and in that world and the sort of like meta sort of aspect of both of those realities and watching it. I mean, we obviously, this show is about this program, but for both things to exist in these parallel ways and also in my brain is I don't know exactly what the question is, but I'll tell you the answer for me is that it's very strange.
Was it strange for any of you guys? Can any of you guys remember the first moon landing or how you felt about the U.S. astronaut program? Were there any of you guys who could remember being a little kid and maybe wanting to be an astronaut and then getting to play one?
You know, I think one of the things about this that was strange, I mean, no, I remember some of the, you know, shuttle missions, but I definitely not old enough to remember the, you know, Apollo 11 or anything. But for a story that has a famous book written about it, and I know that, you know, Patrick Adams has loved the book, loved the story, but I think for a lot of people, and I'm one of these people, even though it had been and is a famous book and was adapted into, you know, a huge movie, the story of the Mercury Seven was one that I wasn't familiar with. I think I knew John Glenn by name only, but one of the, you know, educational pieces of information from the story was that these guys were all test pilots, true for Mercury, Gemini, and I think even Apollo. And what a test pilot meant in the 1950s and 60s, what that job entailed, what it did to actually push these aircrafts to the point of malfunction and somehow, you know, live to tail the tail and get up and do it again the next day was super surprising. So, you know, I wasn't old enough to obviously remember these events. But I think so many people in my generation, and certainly generations younger, who are really familiar with the Apollo program, this was just a really kind of exciting educational process on top of, you know, the job itself.
Welcome, gentlemen, to the Center for Human Space Exploration.
Sanger S.
Where are the planes?
What planes?
Well. Let's take a look around.
Yeah.
Which of you guys would be the first to sign up for an astronaut mission now, today? Raise your hand. Okay, Patrick, really? James, wow. Colin, just the three of you.
Wow, I thought we had more.
Patrick, why would you do that now?
I mean, I've always wanted to go to space. It's a bucket list thing. And now, even more now that, like, I don't know, it just looks safer. Back in the day, strapping yourself to the top of a nuclear bomb doesn't seem too exciting or enticing, not knowing if it's going to blow up or not. But watching these SpaceX flights, and then I kind of scour the Virgin Galactic website from time to time, and it just looks like it would be more fun than dangerous. So I'd be on board. Also, just having that perspective of the Earth has been a dream. When you hear astronauts who have gone into orbit or any of the Apollo missions, like, they talk about that experience of seeing Earth from a distance, and how that shifts their perspective so drastically about life on Earth. And it just sounds like something I'd love to experience.
Colin, you said you would like to do that too. Does this story that we're seeing in The Right Stuff reflect anything about today's exploration to you?
I think, look, I think, you know, obviously with the SpaceX and all that kind of stuff, space flight has kind of, you know, come to the forefront again, or it's you know, in people's minds and stuff. And I think, you know, what The Right Stuff does, and you know, to look back on these original seven guys who, you know, none of this would be happening now if it wasn't for what those guys did back then, and, you know, obviously in Russia and stuff like that. But it was sort of, I think that it's, you know, there's something about space and that idea of exploration, and it's like the last sort of place to that we can explore and sort of go. And I think it's always just going to be one of those things that people love and are inspired by. And so I think it's great to look back and sort of take a look at these guys and sort of go, you know, they were willing to, as Jake said, you know, or Patrick said, strap themselves to a nuclear rocket and get launched up when nobody knew what was up there at all. So I think it's a very timely, it's a great time for the show to be coming out.
I have to ask someone who didn't raise their hand, who doesn't want to go to space. Jake, you, after shooting this show, it's not something you'd want to do?
I'll let Patrick do it, and if it goes well, I'll think about it, yeah. I mean, of course,
little,
it's exciting, yeah.
The reverse of the series there.
Yeah. I think it's I guess being in this show, if anything, even though it's kind of an abstract concept, you know, the right stuff, who can have it? What does it mean? These guys that, you know, strap themselves to a nuclear rocket, definitely had something that I don't have. And then look, watching the SpaceX launch, I think like it was back in March, was amazing. I mean, if you kind of bookend the American space program, you know, with, you know, the Mercury program and now this launch that happened this year, what, 51 years after the moon landing, where you have GoPros in the cockpit all the way to blast off. It's kind of, it's nerve wracking. Yeah, no, seriously. I mean, if Patrick makes it and everything goes okay, we'll talk about it.
For me, the biggest terror is not the like getting to space, it's the staying in space. I don't think I'd be able to do that. Like, I want a sort of
Shephard. You want to come right back down.
I want a Shephard length flight. I want just like a quick 15 minutes, sure. Then back down. Any of this
you
Apollo
know,
stuff.
There's a lot of really good virtual reality out now, Patrick, that you might enjoy.
Done.
Yeah.
All right. Never mind. No space for me.
Well, guys, I'm curious because Micah mentioned that we were talking about a scene that he did and it was his audition scene. I'd love to hear from some of you about your audition scenes or the casting process. And Colin, you said you came in pretty late. What's the story there? Why was it so late for you? And do you remember what the audition was like?
Well, I was in Ireland and somebody else had been cast in the role and for whatever reasons, unfortunately, it didn't pan out that way for him. So I got a phone call out of the blue offering me the role, and I had a day to make up my mind. And then I think it was the next morning I was on a flight to Florida four days before we started shooting. So, I had auditioned for, I had taped for previously. So I taped in my house and with my wife reading the scenes. So she says that it's her, up to thanks to her that I got the job, I guess. But it was a funny one. It was very, 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 very last minute. But luckily for me, it worked out well. So, and luckily for all you guys too. I mean, they love me.
No, I was just going to add, I mean, I actually read for Colin's role was my audition experience, I think, because when I was reading, kind of similar to Colin, there was another actor in place to play Shephard. So I came in and actually read for Gordo. And then thought I actually did really terribly because it had been a minute. I was on another show, so I wasn't able to audition for things until that show was officially over with. So it had just been a minute since I had auditioned for anything, and I was rusty. So I auditioned for Gordo and then thought I bombed, and then they brought me back in like 15 minutes later to say, yeah, you're a really bad Gordo. How would you like to play Alan Shepard? So I guess that role opened up and I got to do that. And that happens a lot. And then, like, you know, I know Micah was talking about this, about that scene with Deke that's so good. You know, that scene didn't come until episode, I think, 6. Is that right, Micah? Is that episode 6?
Yeah.
That scene with Deke? Yeah, so, but Mark had written that scene for your audition, you know, before we ever even shot episode 1. And it's another testament to just how good Mark Lafferty is. He did that for a lot of different characters. In fact, sometimes I think he would even write scenes specifically for the auditions. because either, you know, they didn't know where that scene would fall in the chronology of where we'd be, you know, into the season, or it's just a scene to open that character up to see what the actor's capable of. So, the audition process for a show like this, when you have a showrunner like Mark Lafferty and somebody who's such a whip smart talent as Mark Lafferty, able to just throw together beautiful scenes that get to showcase what you can do as an actor, sometimes just for the audition, made the audition process kind of, ideal.
I think one of the Gordo scenes, if I remember, was the dinner table scene with the Glens. I think that was one of the audition scenes for Gordo. And if I remember rightly, I don't think that scene changed at all from the audition to what we actually ended up doing on the day.
Patrick, what about your audition experience?
One of the scenes was the scene where Glenn's reading the magazine that has his face on it, that is foreboding that he may not have what it takes to become part of the Mercury Seven. I don't remember what the other one was. I was so nervous during the audition, to be honest. I kind of blanked out the whole thing because the whole thing meant so much to me. I couldn't believe I was having the opportunity to read for Glenn. But it was a pretty straightforward audition. I went in very nervous. I hadn't auditioned in a really long time. It had been a year since Suits had finished. And it was the first thing that I sort of really felt very passionately about, that I really, really wanted it. And so I went in and was sort of white with anxiety. And then they made me feel much more comfortable. And it was a pretty my favorite part about the audition was that we got through the scenes pretty quickly. And then we ended up just sitting and having a really great conversation about the book. Mark is such a brilliant guy, and Jennifer was so engaged with the material as well that we ended up just having like a remarkable conversation. And I left feeling so much more comfortable than when I went in. And then I had the job just a few days later.
Well, I wanted to talk about some of the scenes that are really outstanding that we've seen on the show. Jake, there's a scene where you guys are in the swimming pool and Ellen has to egress from this mercury capsule that's in the water. How realistically scary and difficult was that to shoot for you?
Micah, you want to take this one?
I saved Jake's life, but I'll let him tell the story.
Yeah, he did. He did. I'll give it to him.
Let's hear that.
I mean, it's not supposed to be that. Like when you said, you know, swimming pool or escape from the castle, I was trying to think of what that would be. And then, oh, right, the water landing scene. That was like a full day of shooting in the pool. I think the way they had it was in the shallow end of the pool. They had these like sandbags holding up light stands underwater that were just kind of propping up the capsule on its side. And then I was inside a hollowed out capsule, kind of rocking it back and forth to give the illusion that there was an issue. And then I rocked it back and forth hard enough that there actually became an issue. I think the front of it dipped under the water, and I'm in a spacesuit, right? Which is not buoyant. And so the whole thing began to flood with water, pretty quickly. I wasn't scared, but I was happy to see Micah. Because Micah, without hesitation, dove in there and lifted the whole thing up until the rest of the crew could get there and kind of put it back together. But then the rest of the day, I was just soaked in, like, you know, a combination of wet spacesuit and sweat and Florida heat. It was a long day of shooting.
But, it was a hot day.
It was a very hot day. That was one of the things that I was surprised. Yeah, Trotter, you remember how hot those suits were in Florida? Yeah. And it took like three people to get them off if you had to pee or anything. So you're pretty much committed to that sweat box for like a 12-hour shoot day in Florida heat.
At least you were in the water. Michael and I were just standing by the side and the sun watching you. So at least you got cooled down.
That was refreshing for like the 18 seconds it took to happen. Then like squishing around in a wet spacesuit the rest of the day was awful. But
the point is that Mike is.
But total wish fulfillment. Living the dream.
To be clear, where I was holding capsule and when the stunt team jumped in was like 0.5 seconds. The stunt team was very much on the
no. Micah held it up and his biceps ripped his shirt open and
You guys also, you know, you did the training simulation on that spinning chair. How close was that to reality? Did you actually do that? Who maybe had a tough time on that chair?
It was only Jake and I did it.
Well, there was the spinning. You mean? Oh, we're talking about the mastiff.
The
right?
mastiff.
Oh yeah. Mastiff. Oh, I had a tough time.
I didn't. I was excellent on it. So
you only had to do it like a third the amount of time that I did. But you're right. He was much better at it. I was supposed to be bad at it because Shephard suffers from the inner ear problem. So
it was a method thing.
That's right. Yeah, I let myself be bad at it.
You did have to sort of, you know, be all disoriented and stuff like that. And it's quite fast when you're in it, you know, and I was able to focus on just one point. And once you do that, then you're fine. But you couldn't do that. And so,
well, Colin, according to Twitter, you learned that trick by playing Captain Hook and staring at the horizon on the ship, right?
That is true. That is true.
You said that on Twitter. I thought I saw that.
It's all sea dog's trick.
Did any of you other guys bring some previous experience on a different series or a different show to your roles? Did you have to like reach in your bag of tricks?
Wow. No, for me, this it was all brand new. I mean, especially with Glenn and, you know, his hair. It was the first time I'd ever had to sit in the hair and makeup trailer for 6 hours, because in the pilot episode, in our first episode, I was going back and forth between suits and the right stuff. So I had to undergo, we had to change my hair to John Glenn hair, and then I had to go back to be Mike Ross for the last couple of episodes of Suits. So that was like a 6.5 hour makeup situation. So that was brand new for me. And then pretty much everything else from there, the dialect, it was all new.
Well, you guys play characters who have an incredible rivalry with each other on screen. Did that ever spill over into off screen? Did you feel competitive with each other?
Michael and I don't talk much anymore, but that's...
Mario Kart?
Wrestling, I remember that happening.
Yeah, wrestling. We wrestled. We played Mario Kart. That got pretty hectic.
Arm wrestling. Yeah, Patrick liked to arm wrestle. So yeah,
loved to arm wrestle.
Who's the champion arm wrestler?
I think me. Well, I think Jake could have won, but he didn't want to play. I remember Jake not.
I didn't play.
To participate. He didn't want to participate. Because he was.
I'm gonna scared. Let everyone just. No, I just thought everyone could. No.
He was scared to win. I think he knew he would dominate.
I knew. I knew it would crush you. It was all you had.
Yeah. It still is.
Well, Michael, when we were in Orlando, you told me at a certain point you had all moved out of the apartments you were staying in, and there was kind of a roommate situation that developed. You and Michael Trotter. We're crashing at Colin O'Donoghue's house. Did you guys get into any kind of mischief there?
Me? I told you that?
Yeah.
That was definitely towards the end of the shoot. You just tell the press.
Micah or Michael, so I didn't want to have to be responsible. Yeah, we had a great time. Colin, very kind. It was just, you know, our places were up, and Colin, you know, we knew we were all going to hang out a lot the last couple weeks of shooting anyway, so we're like, let's just really do it up and have the college experience that I never had. No, we had a great time. We were shooting every day, so it was kind of just a crash pad, and then we'd hang out and go to set the next.
I think I stayed there the last two nights or something. Yes. without really asking.
I came out one morning and I saw Jake was in my house, and I went, oh, I guess Jake's moved in
now
too.
Yeah, pretty much.
Patrick, was there ever a moment during filming where, having done all this research, you were shooting something that was like, this doesn't feel right, or maybe he would do that instead?
Well, Jake and I joke all the time about how you know, we had both done a lot of research and you'd spend so much time talking to each other and comparing notes and like all this stuff before we'd ever shot anything. And then the first day, you know, super easy day. I think we had one maybe tough scene, but but the first shot was us shaving in the mirror. I mean, it just could not be more, you know, banal, easy. Like, yeah, that's great. Let's just get the shaving shots. You're over there. I'm over here. Camera's here. Let's go. And we get in there and action and we start shaving and you can both feel us go, I have no idea. It's like, I can give you a TED talk on John Glenn. I can tell you everything there is to do. I can give you the best book report you've ever heard. But if you ask me how this guy shaves, I have no idea. And that was the moment where we both realized like, oh, we have to throw, this is where we have to throw everything out. Like at some point you have to take everything you've learned and go, yeah, but you just have to shave, you know? And we have to have fun with it. You have to do whatever you're doing in the moment to figure out how to do this basic movement. So those first few days of just like getting the words out, was super awkward. It was very scary. It was just about starting to like, you know, get comfortable in the skin. And it all felt really like sticky and like, you know, are we getting it? But then I think, you know, when I hear other actors talk about this, it's normal. The first few days is always a little bit like the gears are all turning on and starting to grind and you're figuring out how the machine works. But it was a funny moment, us both shaving and being like, I have no idea how to shave. I don't even know how would John Glenn shave? I could tell you what John Glenn said to his kids before his launch and, you know, but I can't tell you how he would shave in front of the mirror. So we had a good laugh about it, let it go and moved on and figured out how to shave.
There's actually an intense scene between John Glenn and Alan Shepard where they're on a rooftop, where it actually looks like for a minute, Alan's gonna go over. What was it like shooting that?
Well, it helped that we weren't actually on a rooftop.
Yeah, that's true.
That was a bonus.
We were on like a structure that was probably like 8 feet off the ground with blue screen all around us.
But Jake was so sick. It was heroic what he accomplished that day because he was so, so, so sick and brought it.
Probably what happens when you spend 6 months making a show in the 1950s, 1960s, chain smoking herbal cigarettes.
Yeah.
You know, every day, every scene for a long time. It probably takes a toll on your immune system.
Were there any scenes that were particularly memorable or difficult to shoot?
You know, I guess the physically demanding, we talked about the Mastiff. One of the last scenes, I guess on episode 5, we just had a long day of shooting that everybody had to be there while me and Patrick pretty much yelled at each other for 12 hours. I mean, that's kind of par for the course and I guess, you know, making a TV show, but
I think,
you know, to kind of be boxed in doing one scene over and over and over from a bunch of different angles is always kind of, you know, it's a marathon for everybody in the scene.
I think also the last scene we shot, it was the fire was the last thing that we shot, right? Like that was the last thing we shot for the whole series. So that was pretty memorable. I thought it was kind of nice that we ended that fireside scene with all the guys and we all had an opportunity to, it was just a scene that involved everybody. It was a way to sort of close out this whole experience. Mm-hmm. That was pretty memorable, even though at the time we were exhausted. I think while that was happening, we all kind of took it all in and had a moment to say goodbye. It was cool.
Well, we're out of time. Thank you so much, all of you guys, for doing this. We are so excited to watch the finale of The Right Stuff.